Okay, so at the end of the last class, we were looking at the definition of noise margins, right? So what we saw was the noise margins are essentially defined as, or rather the noise limits are the points where any further increase in the input voltage is going to cause an amplified effect at the output, right? It's going to sort of increase the change at the output stage, right? So for example, when you have a curve which looks something like this, obviously not going below that, anything beyond this, these two points over here, right? Okay, I'm just calling the noise limits. That's not the normal term that's used, but the idea is to sort of indicate that when the input voltage goes out of those range, so beyond the increases beyond the low value and decreases beyond the high value, in that intermediate range, any change in input voltage causes an amplified effect at the output. Okay, so that's undesirable. That's not the kind of thing that we normally want from a digital gate. As far as a digital gate's behavior is concerned, what we expect is that even if the input is sort of noisy or is not a pure digital signal, the output should be as close to the final pure digital value as possible. Okay, so this region in between is undesirable. So with that, we could also define a concept of VIL and VIH, VIL being the highest input which is still considered low, VIH is the lowest input which is still considered high. Ideally, what would we like those to be? Both of them at the midpoint. So VIL should be equal to VIH, should be equal to VDD by 2. That's the ideal situation, right? And so this would be VIL, this would be VIH. The corresponding outputs would be VOL and VOH, right? And we define the noise margins basically as the noise margin on the high side is VOH minus VIH, and the noise margin on the low side is VIL minus VOL. Okay. And obviously the noise margins have to be positive, so you can sort of use that to figure out which minus which you need to do. Okay. And we want this to be as large as possible. Ideally, both of these should be equal to VDD by 2. Right? That is VOH equal to VDD, VOL equal to 0, and VIL equal to VIH equal to VDD by 2. Right? That's what we would like to see. But in practice, obviously, we are not going to get that because that would require a sort of perfect brick wall transfer characteristic. Right? So instead, let us see if we can estimate what this value is going to be for the CMOS inverter that we constructed using one PMOS and one NMOS transistor. Right? So the shape of the voltage transfer characteristic looks something like what I've drawn over here. Right? There are a couple of things that we can see from this. One is that if I actually try to sort of write out a continuous VO versus VI functional equation, I'm going to find it very hard because the way that I have gone about constructing this equation is to first sort of split the transistor into different regions of operation, right? Linear, saturation, velocity saturation, and so on. And then sort of figure out which current equation should be written based on which path it is in. So in other words, these are sort of piecewise continuous equations. Right? So writing one consolidated equation that sort of captures all of these effects is at least, I don't know how to do it. Okay? So what we do instead is we say, all right, let's make an approximation. Right? For any of the things that we are doing hand calculations, the important point is how do we make intelligent approximations that give us some insight into the behavior of the circuit. Okay? So the approximations that we are going to make now are just like many of the other approximations we have been making, are not very accurate, but they are useful because they give you insight into what determines the behavior of the circuit, okay, and what you should look for in order to get good noise margins. That's all that we care about. Okay, beyond that, to actually find the noise margin, what do? You simulate, plot, use numerical methods in order to find out the exact noise margins. Okay, alright, so how do I approximate this? Right. What I'm going to do is to say, I will approximate that entire voltage transfer characteristic as three segments. Okay. What are these three segments? This initial region is one where I consider it to be flat. Then there is one linear region. Okay, there is an initial region for low values of Vi where it is completely flat and the output is equal to VDD. For somewhat high values of Vi, the output I am going to assume is exactly zero, not close to zero, exactly zero. I will demarcate the points where it transitions from those, join those two points with a straight line. Okay. So the first thing that we can see over there is, if that happens, right, I no longer have this ability to sort of define a slope of minus 1, because there is no point at which the slope is equal to minus 1. It's going to be 0 and then abruptly change to some s and then once again change to 0. So I'm using a piecewise linear approximation over here, right? But what I'm going to say is that these two points, right, are essentially going to be my VIL and VIH. Okay, how does this help me in terms of finding out the noise margins, right? The assumption that I am further making is VOH is equal to VDD and VOL is equal to 0. Okay, that's just corresponding to whatever is seen in this graph. Now the useful part about this is I will have a midpoint somewhere over here, right? This is going to be VM. And the slope around Vm is going to be that constant value S, okay, whatever it is. So effectively what we are saying, in other words, is if I can calculate this value, S is equal to dVo by dVi at Vi equal to Vm, or Vo also equal to Vm, both are the same, right? If I define S that way, then what I can say is that VIL is going to be given by how much? What will it be? Given this, given what I have of the equation so far, how can I calculate VIL given the information that I have so far? Correct. So what will it be? It is a straightforward slope calculation, right? How do you write it? What is VIL in terms of the parameters that we have so far, right? Like you pointed out, it's just a straight line equation that we are talking about, right? So this delta that I have over here is VDD. How much is this going to be? I still remember this. It's many more years since I left high school than you did. Right? VDD by S, that's the definition of slope. It's a straight line segment that is joining those two points. Right? So the change in Vi that causes a VDD change in Vo, assuming that it's on a straight line. Right? So VDD by S is what we have over here. So then what is this going to be? Oh, sorry. That's going to be VDD by 2S. Right, because Vm is VDD by 2, assuming that Vm is VDD by 2. If Vm is not VDD by 2, of course you can adjust that equation and so on and so forth. Right? So VIL will essentially be equal to Vm minus VDD by 2S, and VIH is going to be equal to Vm plus VDD by 2S, right? Now, as far as we are concerned, we don't really care about the exact values of VIL and VIH. the only way of getting those is to actually run simulations and, you know, numerically compute what those values are. What qualitatively, what can you tell me about what you would like to see in this equation? The slope should be as large as possible, right? So S should be as high as possible. That's all that you really care about, right? So that VIL and VIH both become as close to VM as possible, right? In order to do that, you would like the slope S to be as large as possible, so that that delta is brought down. A small change in VI is enough to cause that change of VDD by 2 or VDD minus VI, whatever it is. Right? So now let's see how we can estimate the value of S. Right? Here once again we are going to play another trick on the system. Right? What can we say about the functionality of the CMOS inverter around that point, VM? What region of operation are the two transistors going to be? Saturation, right? Probably velocity saturation. So in this case, I'm going to assume velocity saturation. It does not make too much difference, right? You can sort of work it out even in the case of saturation. I'll just assume velocity saturation and go ahead, okay? So let me first write down the equation of what we would say if we tried to equate the two currents under the case of velocity saturation, right? What I would say is IDP would be equal to KP. Now this KP is mu P C aux WP by LP. I'm combining all of those together into KP. Okay. So KP PD sat P into VDD minus VM minus VTP minus VD sat P by 2. Okay. And similarly, IDN is going to be given by KN VD sat N into VM minus VTN minus VD sat N by 2. So what can I do? I can equate both of these equations, thereby compute VM in terms of all other known parameters and so on. We already did that yesterday in order to estimate VM, right? But here's the problem. Where is VO in this? I'm interested in finding out dVO by dVI, right? But I don't even see VO in the equation. So what's the catch? What can I do about this? The fact that VO is missing from the equation. Why is VO missing? Because we have assumed velocity saturation. By the definition of velocity saturation, we essentially said that the current is no longer dependent on the VDS, the output voltage. It has saturated because of VD sat. But if you look at the transfer, the functional characteristics, ID versus VDS, is it truly independent of VDS? What am I saying over here? If I look at ID versus VDS, what do I expect the curve to look like? Like this. What does it actually look like? There is a small slope over here, right? This is the dependence on VDS. What effect is that? Channel length modulation. Okay. So surprisingly enough, what we are effectively seeing over here is, if I ignore the effect of channel length modulation, I cannot do this computation. So very conveniently, I'll bring channel length modulation into the picture and put it in the equation. Am I just doing it for convenience? Is this something which is, you know, just sort of playing with the numbers? Not really. this is an example of a case where, see, normally we would have approximated the channel length modulation effect and said it can be ignored. What we are saying over here is this is one place where it cannot be ignored because all the other effects have cancelled out. Only channel length modulation is significantly playing a part on that slope in that region. Okay? So now let's write out the same equations and equate the two currents, but now including the channel length modulation parameter. Okay? What we will get is this long equation. Where VO is the Vout, okay, the output voltage, right? Now, we have one equation which relates VI and VO, and everything else here is known: KP, KN, VD sat P, VD sat N, VDD, even the VA, the actual value of VI is known, right? We know that it is at VM that we are interested in it. But it's not something where we are actually interested in just solving for that. We are more interested in under the condition that this equation is satisfied. How do I find out this? Okay, so effectively what I'm going to do is just differentiate on both sides, right? What will I get? I'll get wherever I differentiate with respect to VI, the terms multiplying VI will just become one, and whatever that constant of multiplication, the terms multiplying VO will become that into dVO by dVI. Any constant terms will go away. Finally, I'll get an equation in which I can rearrange terms. dVO by dVI is something as a function of VI and various other parameters that we have over here. Okay? So what I'm going to do is straight away just cut through all of that and write down what the final equation looks like. It is a somewhat complex equation. Okay? But I'll write it down anyway because there are a couple of interesting takeaways that we need to understand from this. Okay. Long equation, but if you look carefully at it, it's easy to understand what's going on, right? What is this term? And correspondingly, what is this term? ID and IN. Okay? Which, since we are sort of finding them at the same point, are actually equal. So I'm just going to write it as I, the total current flowing through under that condition that the input voltage is equal to this VM, whatever it is. Okay. When we are designing the transistor, right, normally this VO term and VDD minus VO, what can we say about those? What do we expect in this region? What do we expect the value of VO to be? VDD by 2, right? So we approximately want this to be VDD by 2. right? Kn Vd sat n versus Kp Vd sat p. What are you going to choose those values? Normally we would choose the Wp by Wn equal to 2, right? We saw one reason for that yesterday. We will see another reason for it later as we get into the timing analysis. But if we assume Wp by Np is Wp by Wn is equal to 2, then of course the Vd sat p by Vd sat n term also comes into the picture. But approximately this Kn Vd sat n and Kp Vd sat p are in the same order. Either they are close to equal or they are off maybe by a factor of 2 or so, not much more than that. So they are very similar terms. Okay. The 1 plus lambda Vdd by 2, 1 plus lambda Vdd by 2, that lambda into Vdd by 2 is going to be a relatively small term compared to the 1. Why? Because we know that lambda is a small parameter. It's only a second order effect, channel length modulation. Right? So, among all the terms that we have over here, effectively what we are saying in other words is, this is something like some k Vd sat, right? I'm intentionally leaving out the n and p. I'm sort of combining all of those together into some term, divided by, in the denominator I have lambda n plus lambda p times I. Okay. You look at the units, it works out. The k Vd sat would normally be multiplied by another Vgs minus Vt in order to get I. Okay, so k Vd sat by I sort of comes out as one over V term. Okay, and lambda n plus lambda p is a 1 over V parameter. So they sort of cancel out, right? The units cancel out. What can we say from this? Like I said, we are not interested in the exact numbers. We are interested in, what does this tell me as a designer that I should do in order to get a good behavior from this circuit? What's a good behavior? High value of this dVo by dVi, right? The slope I want it to be as high as possible. What are the things I can do to make it high? What are all the parameters that I have over here? The k should be high, right? How do I make k high? It is mu cox W by L. Mu and cox I don't have control over, L is usually kept at minimum length, but W I do have control. So one thing I could do over here is use a larger value of W. Okay, there's a catch that W also shows up in the denominator with the I term. So actually speaking, changing K is not really going to help matters very much, right? Or changing W in this case. Okay. So effectively what we are saying is that the W effect over here W effects cancel out. The Vd sat is sort of a technology constant, which once again you don't have much control over. The important part over here is what remains. 1 over lambda n plus lambda p, right? Again, it is not something in your control, but what this is telling you is the lambda n plus lambda p, the smaller that value is, the greater the slope is going to be. In other words, if the effect of channel length modulation is less, is small, right, it means that you will get a high slope. Intuitively also this makes sense. If my ID versus VDS looked like this chart, right, the solid line versus the dashed line. The solid line is a case where there is almost no channel length modulation. The dashed line is the one where there is channel length modulation. The solid line is better. Okay. So, in other words, this is just sort of bearing out whatever you would have intuitively thought. But you can actually get it in terms of the equations, which tells you how much is likely to be the effect. Okay. Now we can plug numbers in here and also see how much the noise margin is going to be. I'm not going to get into that at the moment. I would suggest you just go back and, you know, put in the numbers and see approximately what kind of values you are going to see for the noise margin for a CMOS inverter. This is not part of the official assignment which we have given on the module, but you can do this with SPICE as well, right? Actually calculate the noise margin. We'll see if we can add in an assignment as far as the noise margins. I think the second assignment may have something on noise margins. Does it have? Okay. We'll see. Anyway, I would suggest you just do this independent of that. Okay? Alright. So, with that, we are sort of done with the static analysis portion of the inverter. Why am I calling it static analysis? Because it is essentially a sort of DC analysis, right? For a fixed value of input voltage, what does the output look like? What happens as I vary that input voltage? How does the output vary? And so on. Okay. Now what I would like to see is the dynamic behavior. How does the inverter sort of function, the current through it, the output voltages and so on, how do they behave as a function of time, right? Therefore, I will have to assume certain things in terms of how the input is changing, how the output is expected to change, and the most important part is the capacitances associated with the various parts of the transistors will now come into the picture. Okay? And we are now going to try and do an analysis of how the delay through this inverter can be defined in terms of the various capacitances and how we can sort of characterize the delay as a function of load. Okay. So we are considering a situation where there is an inverter driving something which will mark as CL, a load. Okay? And we need to sort of understand what that load is and so on. So what we are going to do is take a more specific case, an inverter driving another identical inverter. Okay? So by the way, before we get to that, we will use the term reference inverter to indicate this scenario. Wp equal to 8 lambda, Wn equal to 4 lambda, Lp equal to Ln equal to 2 lambda. Right? Where lambda is 90 nanometers, so 2 lambda is 180 nanometers. So the Wp is 8 lambda, Wn is 4 lambda. Right? This is sometimes also called the minimum sized inverter. Strictly speaking, the minimum sized inverter would probably be Wp equal to 2 lambda, Lp equal to 2 lambda, Wn equal to 2 lambda, Ln equal to 2 lambda, right? That's the smallest in terms of feature sizes that you can make. But for various reasons, we have seen why you don't want to get down to 2 lambda for the W. That's primarily layout influenced. And you want the Wp to be greater than Wn. That is influenced by the fact that the mobility of the holes is less than that of electrons. So we sort of define the reference inverter or the unit inverter, right? As this particular configuration. Okay? And in fact, one of the things that you will sometimes see over here is one way by which we may write it is basically something like this, 8 and 4, right? I'll just write the 8 and 4, the lambdas are implicit, the lengths are implicit. So this tells us directly what is the configuration used on that particular gate. Okay. So what I'm interested in is a scenario where one such reference inverter is connected, its output is connected to another reference inverter. Okay. Why am I interested in this scenario? Because it is a relatively common scenario that you are going to encounter in logic circuits. Not that just an inverter driving another inverter, but an inverter driving a load which looks like another inverter. In what sense does it look like another inverter? It will also be the gate terminals of some other transistors, okay. The sizes of those transistors will be similar to what the other inverter looks like. So from the point of view of the range of capacitance, the nature of the capacitance, the fact that it varies as a function of voltage, all of those things are taken into account when I take an inverter and drive another inverter, rather than driving a fixed capacitive load. Okay. So I would like to see what happens if I take an inverter and drive another identical inverter to start with. Okay. So first things first, if I just consider inverter driving capacitance, right, and I assume that the input is going low over here. Okay, initially it was high output, then it's going low. What do you expect to see over here in the output? Initially it was low, it will then go high. Okay. What is the equivalent circuit that I can use in order to represent this transition? Effectively, during that transition, when the input goes from high to low, what is happening? Initially the NMOS is on, the PMOS is off. Finally, the PMOS is on, the NMOS is off. If I assume for the time being that that transition is abrupt, okay, zero rise time at the input or zero fall time at the input, right? Effectively, it looks as though I have a situation where I have VDD, I have the PMOS transistor, it is driving a capacitive load with some current ID. The input of the PMOS is grounded, meaning that the VGS across it is VDD itself. Okay, so this is the circuit that we have. Right? We already did some estimations of what equivalent resistance and so on are. Based on that, what I'm going to say is this is equivalent to the same VDD and one R equivalent of the PMOS transistor driving CL. Okay? But that's not the end of the story. I have something a little bit more over here that I need to worry about. Okay? There are some additional capacitances. Where are those capacitances coming from? Huh? The gate capacitance of the PMOS, do I need to worry about it? What's happening at the gate of the PMOS? I have grounded it. Okay, I'm assuming that that transition was abrupt. Does it affect the output? Look at the gate terminal of the PMOS, right? I'm assuming that I've just grounded that gate terminal. How did I do it magically? That, forget about it for the time being. The question is, does it affect the output directly? Doesn't look like, right? So for the time being, we are going to ignore that effect. It does not have a direct effect. The gate capacitance of the PMOS transistor does not have a direct effect on the delay at the output. It has a second order effect. We'll get to that later based on the slew of the input and so on. But for the time being, I'm assuming ideal transition at the input. Okay. So, next step, there is a drain diffusion capacitance, right? The junction capacitance corresponding to the PN junction, reverse bias PN junction on the drain. There is also a similar junction capacitance on the source. Do I need to worry about the source capacitance? Where is the source capacitance in this case? This is the source capacitance, right? It is connected between the source terminal and the bulb, which is VDD. So both are VDD in this case, right? So there is effectively no change in the voltage across that capacitance. It does not affect anything at the output. The drain, on the other hand, CD or CDB, drain to bulb, this definitely does have an effect on the output because it is connected between the output terminal and the bulb. The voltage across it is changing. okay? Not just that, I conveniently left out the NMOS transistor over here because it is cut off. Okay, so no current can flow through the NMOS transistor. But its source terminal, or rather its drain terminal, is still reverse biased. There is still a reverse biased PN junction over there. That capacitance will still play an effect over here. Right? So whatever we have over here, this NMOS transistor, whose gate is grounded, source is also grounded. This one CS is also insignificant, but the CD is going to be significant. So I'll call the CDP and CDN. Okay? So in other words, in addition to this CL that I have over here, I have two more capacitances. CD of the NMOS. CD of the PMOS is going to VDD, but this is an incremental condition that I am considering, right? I am essentially looking at the delta V across the capacitance and seeing what effect it has on the time that it takes, right? The fact that the voltage is increasing or decreasing across it doesn't matter. The capacitance just opposes it, opposes that change. So it doesn't matter whether I draw that CDP going to VDD or to ground. In the incremental analysis, it is the same. It is just, it can be treated as a capacitance going to ground to a fixed voltage. Right? The other end of the capacitance is at a fixed voltage. So, in other words, what's going to end up happening is R equivalent is the equivalent source resistor, or the equivalent resistance of the PMOS transistor. The supply source voltage is VDD. That is now going into a total capacitance, which is CL plus CDN plus CDP. Okay? And as a first order estimate of the delay, if I throw away the 0.69, that is the, you know, log 2 term, I can effectively say that the delay through the stage is just the RC, right? CL plus CDN plus CDP. Okay? So effectively, for this condition that we have considered, right? The inverter input is falling from high to low, output is going from low to high, current is being sourced through the PMOS transistor and fed into whatever capacitance is there at the output terminal until the voltage there rises towards VDD. The propagation delay for that transition, the RC time constant of that propagation delay, which we will call the propagation delay, is R equivalent, which is the equivalent resistance of that transistor, multiplied by the load plus the CDN and CDP. The CDN and CDP are not part of the load. They are not really something which I want to have. They are just there because the transistor has a diffusion capacitance, a junction capacitance. I cannot get rid of it. Because of that, I call these parasitic capacitances. Right? They are parasites. They are sort of draining away part of the current which could have been used to charge the output and preventing it from charging as fast as it could. They are undesirable. Okay? Ideally, even the CL may be undesirable. Ideally, I would like to see a zero transition delay, zero propagation delay. But CL is at least something out of my control. It is something imposed by the next stage. CDN and CDP are part of my own gate, the gate that I am actually considering. Just the fact that I am trying to source a current over there means that those capacitances are going to exist. Therefore, they are called parasites. Okay? So, this is the equivalent rising propagation delay, right? The approximate rising propagation delay that we can get over here. Right? So, now we will also look at what happens in the case of the falling propagation delay. right? What would that look like? So I assume that the input has gone high, the output was initially high and then goes low. In this case, what is the equivalent circuit? The NMOS transistor with its gate connected to VDD and therefore on is going to discharge current coming from the CL. Okay. There is going to be a CDN, same as before, it has not really changed because the CDN and CDT depend on the area of diffusion. They have nothing to do with whether it was a falling or rising transition or which one was actually the driving gate, driving transistor, right? There is a PMOS transistor over here whose VGS is 0 and therefore it is cut off, but its CDP is still there. Right? So what does the delay through this become? Tau is equal to RCL is equal to R equivalent of the NMOS, right? So I'll go back and make this R equivalent of the PMOS. R equivalent of NMOS times same CL, same CDN, same CDP. Okay? So the C part of it, the total load capacitance, does not change whether it's a rising or falling propagation delay. Right? The parasitics remain the same in both cases, the load capacitance remains the same. If there is any difference in the propagation delay, it is primarily going to be because of the difference in R equivalent. Okay? So this tells us one important thing over here, which is that if I want to make those two delays equal, right, I want to make the system somewhat symmetric. I want to make sure that the rising propagation delay and the falling propagation delay are equal. What should I do? The R equivalent should be made equal, right? But what do we know about R equivalent? We had an expression for it, an approximate expression, right? What was that? 3 by 4 VDD by ISAT, IDSAT, right? N or P as the case may be for a R equivalent N or R equivalent P. VDD is a constant. IDSAT P is primarily determined by what? Mu n Cox W by L VD sat n into some term which is pretty much a constant. Okay? Or alternatively, it's going to be mu p Cox WP by LP VD sat p into something else. Right? Ideally, we would like these numbers, the R equivalents, to be close. Ideally, we would like them to be exactly equal, but we would at least like them to be close. Okay? And based on the fact that there is a difference in mobility and based on the fact that there is, you know, the VDSAT and VDSAT P also could be different, right? We don't try and make this a very accurate, exact equivalence. What we say is, by choosing WP equal to 2WN, it comes close enough. Right? That we can actually use this as a good approximation for our design. Okay? Right? So R equivalent P is close to R equivalent N under those conditions. Okay. if you plug in the exact numbers, you might get a different value. You might get that the WP by WN should be 3, or you might get that maybe even 4, right? But the point is that 2 is good enough to give us within a sufficiently close range that we can use it for all practical purposes without having heavily skewed transistors. What do I mean by skewed transistors? Very different sizes, right? I do not want the NMOS and PMOS to be of very different sizes either, because then my layout will get messed up. I will have a large area occupied by the PMOS, relatively very small area occupied by the NMOS. I don't want that. So this is a good trade-off. A factor of 2 turns out to be a good design choice. Okay, so this is one of the main reasons why we sort of choose these things to be in this ratio, the WP by WN to be in the 2:1. Okay, alright, we will stop here for now. Okay, and when we continue, essentially what we are going to do is look at the actual values of CDN and CDP, can we relate them to what the load capacitance looks like and so on, and thereby get further insights into the propagation delay of a circuit.